Thank you. Please be seated, and good morning, Lawrence. Happy Inauguration Day. How are you all doing today? Good. It's great to see a standing room crowd only here in Memorial Chapel. What a wonderful day. I hope you enjoyed yesterday afternoon's stimulating panel discussions about civility and diversity, as well as the reception and the Lawrence Performs musical extravaganza across the campus last evening. It has been said that music is in Lawrence's veins. This morning is another indication that this is indeed true, and you will be happy to note there's more to come. A warm welcome to the inauguration ceremony and investiture of Lawrence University's 16th president, Mark Burstein. Welcome to students, faculty, staff, alumni, trustees, Appleton and Fox City's community members, delegates from over 60 colleges, universities, learned societies, and academia consortia, and numerous family, friends, and colleagues of our new president. For some of you, this is your first trip to Appleton and Lawrence, and we hope you have a great visit and you return often. And also welcome to those who are with us via webcast across the U.S., as well as the overflow crowd in the cinema in the Warsh Campus Center. Thanks to everyone for joining us this morning. I'm Terry Franke, the class of 1968. I'm from Winnetka, Illinois. It is my pleasure to serve as the chairman of the Board of Trustees of Lawrence University. The Board of Trustees has many responsibilities, and one of our roles is to select and then inaugurate our president. So this is quite an important moment for Lawrence, historic and exciting. It isn't often we inaugurate a new president. Raise your hand if this is the first presidential inauguration. For many of you, it is. Let's relish this moment. We have three agenda items in our inauguration program this morning. Some brief welcome comments, readings, greetings, and addresses from members of the Lawrence and Appleton communities, as well as honored guests. And then the investiture of our 16th president, followed by his inaugural remarks. Please join us following the ceremony for reception in Shattuck Hall and the Music Drama Center. Before the ceremony begins, I have three brief welcome comments, several thank yous, several recognitions, and a few observations about our new president. First is our thank yous for the musical performances this morning at our inauguration ceremony. Thank you to our organist, Professor Catharine Hanford, trumpeters John Daniel and Jeff Stannard, and violinist Samantha George and Brandon Kruker. Thank you to the Inauguration Fanfare Ensemble. Thank you to the amazing gamelan Kahasa Asri. The gamelan is the beautiful instrument from Bali behind us on the stage. And thank you to the Cantala Women's Choir. In addition, I want to thank everyone with me on the chapel stage for their participation in this inauguration ceremony. I offer special thanks to two people, to Shirley Tilghman, President Emerita of Princeton University, and Catharine Bond Hill, President of Vassar College, who will be presenting shortly. Lawrence is forever grateful to both of you for mentoring Mark, for encouraging him to pursue a dream to become president of a liberal arts college, and providing great examples of inspirational leadership. Second, I want to recognize two committees without whose efforts we would not be here today. First is our Presidential Search Committee under the leadership of Trustee Dale Hsu, which worked so diligently last year in a very collaborative effort to help select Mark from a very deep candidate pool and then convince him to come to Lawrence. Second is our Transition Steering Committee under the leadership of Trustee Mike Sisler, which has worked for 18 months to help with our presidential transition, including the gala celebration last May, honoring the contributions and achievements of our 15th president, Jill Beck, as well as organizing every detail of this spectacular inauguration weekend and ceremony. Lawrence is extremely grateful to these two committees, composed of faculty, students, staff, alums, and trustees, for their contributions to making our presidential transition so successful. And third are my comments about our new president, Mark Burstein. On this stage, on January 3rd, I introduced Mark Burstein to the Lawrence community and shared several observations about him. I would like to update you on my observations on Mark based on his 115 days since he assumed office on July 1. By now, you sense that I think in terms of threes. So I have three observations I want to share about our new president. First is his background. From the initial presidential candidate pool, we're very intrigued by his unique set of experiences. Service in economic development for two departments of New York City government, investment banker, consultant, as well as almost 20 years of senior leadership roles at Columbia and Princeton, two of the country's leading research universities. Mark's background and perspective have already proven to be extremely valuable as we tackle complex issues related to the affordability and value of a private liberal arts education. Second is his collaborative style of leadership. We noticed this quality throughout the presidential search. Here are comments we heard from on-campus during the on-campus interview process. Engaging, smart, sensible, open, transparent, thoughtful, approachable, inclusive, respectful, articulate, and self-confident, but not arrogant. I'm very pleased to report that Mark has exhibited all these qualities and traits, and more, since he became president in early July. His inclusive style leadership inspires confidence, his openness and transparency engenders trust. And third is his affinity and passion for the liberal arts. We sense that Mark was dedicated to the core academic mission of the liberal arts, as well as embrace the deep and rich transformative nature of the Lawrence residential campus experience. It was also clear that Mark liked Lawrence. He made a stealth visit to Lawrence before becoming the finalist candidate, and a campus tour with Pablo Galvan, an international student from Mexico, who had no idea he was guiding a future president. From that time, it was clear that Mark liked Lawrence. I mentioned in January that I hoped that Mark would come to love Lawrence like many of us in this room do. I am pleased to report today that indeed Mark has come to love Lawrence. At the beginning of our presidential search, I sought the advice of Dick Chait, an expert in college and university governance at the Harvard University School of Education. Dick said that our role was to find the best marriage partner for Lawrence. While we were still in the honeymoon process, I'm fairly confident that we found an incredible partner in Mark Burstein, and Lawrence's future is extremely bright and positive. So let's sit back and relish this moment and time together. Let's let the ceremony begin, and will our alumni representatives, Christine Jones-Benedict and Jamie Reeve, please join me on the podium.
Thank you, Terry. Lawrence University's legendary freshman studies course introduces students to a high standard of reading, discussion, and writing. For many years, Plato's work, The Republic, has been included in the first term of freshman studies. Plato wrote that work to help us sharpen our capacity for judgment to the point where we could transcend mere opinion and discover knowledge about the things that really matter. He uses several extended metaphors to make his argument. The metaphor of the cave is recognizable to every Laurentian as pertaining to the advantages of a lifelong liberal arts education.
Excerpts from Book 7 of The Republic. I want you to picture the enlightenment or ignorance of our human condition. Imagine an underground cave with a long entrance open to the daylight. In this chamber are prisoners, held captive since childhood, their legs and necks so fastened that they can only look straight ahead. They cannot turn their heads. Above them is a road. Between the road and the prisoners, a curtain has been built, like the screen at a puppet show between the operator and the audience. Imagine further that there are people passing along the road behind the curtain, talking with each other and carrying on all sorts of objects.
I see. The prisoners would assume that the shadows on the curtain were the real things. And if they heard the voices of the passers-by, they would assume that those voices belonged to the shadows as well. To them, the truth is nothing but shadows.
Now think what would happen to them if they were released from their bonds and cured of their delusions.
The process would be a painful one, for when they emerged into the light, their eyes would be so dazzled by the glare that they wouldn't be able to see a single thing.
They would need to grow accustomed to the light before they could see things clearly outside the cave. At first, it would be easiest to look at the sunlit shadows, then the reflections of objects in water, then the heavenly bodies in the night sky, and last of all, at the sun itself. They would understand that it is by the sun that we see everything in the visible world.
Your simile is clear. The prison corresponds to the realm revealed by sight, and the ascent to the upper world with the upward progress of the mind into what is intelligible. And this movement is a capacity that is innate in each one's mind. For the organ by which we learn is like an eye that cannot be turned from darkness to light unless the whole body is turned. In the same way, the mind as a whole must be turned away from the world of change until its eye can bear to look straight at reality.
Thank you. Good morning, President Burstein, Laurentians and guests, both those visiting and those joining us through webcast. My name is Nick Paulson. I'm a member of the Lawrence Class of 2014, and I'm the president of the Lawrence University Community Council. On behalf of the 1,500 students here and abroad, the academic and extracurricular opportunities offered by over 95 student organizations, the academic departments, and the majors in interdisciplinary programs of Lawrence University, I have the honor of formally welcoming President Burstein as the 16th president of our university. What we, the students of Lawrence University, need is a president who, in the words of former president Rick Warsh, constantly reminds us that our business here is to learn, and that this learning is not just academic. We need to be reminded that, as students, we should embrace the learning and growth from the social and, dare I say it, fun in our time at Lawrence. We need to be reminded that we are students in a community, an intentionally formed community, that, though it carries certain obligations, also offers innumerable opportunities to meet others, to learn from them, and to come to a better understanding of each other. And we need to be reminded that conflict is not always a bad thing, that it is, first and foremost, an opportunity to grow, to deepen our understanding of someone different from ourselves. I remember my first dinner with Mark, when he expressed these very sentiments, and every time I see his smiling face, beaming his way across campus, I can't help but be reminded that Lawrence is a place for learning, for community, and certainly a place for fun. So to you, Mark, 16th president of Lawrence University, welcome. We look forward to the smiles, we look forward to the fun, and we look forward to seeing what you do here.
Mr. Chairman, President Burstein, Lawrence faculty members, distinguished alumni, students, and friends of Lawrence University, it is my honor and privilege to bring greetings from the city that exists because Lawrence exists. It is by no means a coincidence that Appleton's Main Street is and always will be College Avenue. It is an honor to be with you on what is truly a milestone for both Lawrence University and the city of Appleton. I'm well aware that the histories of each are equally rich, and I have every confidence that the futures of both Lawrence and Appleton are full of promise. The city and college grew concurrently from the seeds planted by one family when Amos Lawrence wed Sarah Appleton in Boston nearly 185 years ago. The Appleton-Lawrence connection was born. It has been a long, distinguished, and gratifying relationship. I believe that our founding mother and father would no doubt take pride. They would take pride in the fact that both Lawrence University and the city of Appleton have blossomed. Today, College Avenue remains the heart of the city with its vibrant businesses and lively entertainment. This year, highlighted by the new Houdini Plaza and the magnificent Mile of Music Festival, which counts Lawrence among its strongest supporters. Lawrence also continues its focus on the river that carried the first president here 168 years ago. The Warsh Campus Center, with its magnificent views of the river, is the latest addition to the recent campus facilities taking advantage of our precious resource. And continuing to follow the university's lead, the city has promoted redevelopment along the river with Eagle Flats, River Heath, and the remediation of the old Foremost Dairy site, all in the Lawrence neighborhood. Lawrence and Appleton have always endeavored to pursue excellence, be it educational, artistic, industrial, or with great and good service to society. We desire to be leaders in all that we do. I'm proud of the collaborative relationship we have fostered, and I'm anxious to work with President Burstein and learn which of his Big Apple experiences may apply to the Little Big Apple. His interest in local government and his vision for Lawrence's role in that concept we call community couldn't be more exciting for me. I have every confidence that the faculty, alumni, and students that wear, have worn, or will soon wear gowns at Lawrence will teach, learn, perform, create, and find ways of making our greater community a richer place to live and learn. I also have every confidence that the citizens of Appleton will continue to be full participants in the performances, exhibitions, lectures, and those other activities that constitute the laboratory of the creative and inquisitive mind, which has always been at the core of the arts and liberal learning here at Lawrence. The college's motto is light, more light. Today, we celebrate that light that is Lawrence and bask in its glory. Mark Burstein, you will be a worthy torchbearer. President Burstein, Wisconsin people are enthusiastic and loyal. In settling into the Fox Valley, we invite you to share our enthusiasm for a great Wisconsin sports franchise. The Green Bay Packers.
Mark, congratulations on your inauguration. Really pleased for you. And I want to officially welcome you to Wisconsin. As a fellow president of a major league organization within the state, it's great to have you here and look forward to working with you. And we're going to have somebody here present you a Packers jersey, number 16, to officially recognize you as the 16th president of the National I hope that I could be there, but I am in the process of traveling with our team. We are about to play another Vikings team. Unfortunately, this Vikings team, or fortunately, I guess, is not in Wisconsin, but I'm in Minneapolis and can't be there this evening. We're taking on the Vikings, hopefully another big win over them, but did want to wish you the best and congratulations again on your selection as Lawrence's 16th president.
I believe that is a first. In the annals of academia. It is truly an honor for me to extend greetings to the Lawrence University community on the occasion of the inauguration of Mark Burstein as your new president. I congratulate the members of the Presidential Search Committee and the Board of Trustees. You've chosen wisely and well. Now, I will confess at the outset that this occasion is a true test of my character. For after all, we gather to celebrate Lawrence's gain at Princeton's expense. All of us who had the good fortune to work with Mark Burstein over the last decade lament the loss of a greatly admired friend and colleague. But I'm inspired to rise above my lesser self, as my mother would surely instruct me to do, by the knowledge that in the past, Lawrence has graciously sent its leaders to the Ivy League. Nathan Marsh Pusey to Harvard in 1953, and Henry Merritt Riston to Brown in 1937, just to name two. So I'm consoling myself by thinking of Mark's arrival in Lawrence as payback from the Ancient Eight. Now, there is a reason why Lawrence has produced distinguished leaders for higher education. Since its founding in 1847, Lawrence has embraced liberal education as the best means to prepare citizens for lives of substance. The first graduates of Lawrence went on to become leaders in every walk of life and were instrumental in building the new frontier. Although your current student body represents vastly more diversity than the Germans and Indians of both sexes that were envisaged by your founding fathers, and your curriculum has expanded and deepened with the times, Lawrence's commitment to undergraduate education, and especially to the place of the performing arts in that education, has been unwavering. Through individualized learning in a small community setting, your students are able to explore their interests and talents under the watchful eye and tutelage of dedicated faculty. The residential liberal arts college that Lawrence epitomizes is a unique American brand of education that is the envy of the world. Yet I cannot recall a time when it has been as important for leaders in higher education to forcefully articulate and defend the benefits of a liberal education. Never before has the value of a college education been more vigorously challenged, both within and beyond the gates of colleges and universities. From PayPal co-founder Peter Thiel offering to pay students not to go to college, to Florida politicians proposing differential tuition to students depending upon the perceived value to society of their course of study, the liberal arts are, if not under siege, they're certainly being knocked about. In response to the unacceptably high unemployment rate among recent college graduates, many critics are arguing that a liberal education is a luxury that no student can afford. In its stead, they propose streamlined and targeted vocational training with an emphasis on science and engineering. Both broad liberal arts and vocational training are critical for the successful modern society, but one cannot substitute for the other. For the goal of a liberal education has never been to prepare graduates for their first jobs, but rather for any job. As Lawrence's own mission statement says, a Lawrence education is transformative. We strive to help each student develop as a liberally educated person who can think deeply and creatively about ideas, gather and analyze evidence, communicate effectively, articulate a personal identity that leads to thoughtful life choices, and who is committed to responsible citizenship. And I say amen to that. So this is a time when higher education needs voices like President Mark Burstein. Raised on the campus of Drew University and educated at Vassar College, Mark's commitment to liberal education is bred in the bone, or as we molecular biologists like to say, encoded in his DNA. His experience at Columbia and Princeton reinforced that view while honing his remarkable leadership and administrative abilities. Of course, his friends did worry a little when we discovered that this Jersey boy, transplant to New York City, had never heard of Aaron Rodgers.
Shirley, you're not supposed to say that.
Mark, transparency is very important. And we also learned that he considered that it was cold outside when the thermometer fell below 32 degrees above zero. But I'm not worried. As a recipient of a great liberal arts education, Mark is a lifelong learner. Lawrence stands for excellence and integrity in all that it aspires to do, and Mark Burstein will give new substance and expression to its work. If ever a marriage were made in heaven, I think that this is it. Congratulations, Laurentians.
It's so great to be here today. There's no better excuse to throw a good party than a presidential inauguration. This is a heady occasion for a new president, as exhilarating as it is humbling, as inspiring as it is intimidating. Inaugurations are academic institutions in glorious full flight, a riot of pageantry and plumage, a celebration of who we are, what we do, and who we can become, collectively, as well as in ways unique to single institutions. I'm grateful for the opportunity to make whatever addition I can to these festivities today. I'd certainly like to take the opportunity to congratulate Lawrence University, primarily, of course, for its inspired choice of a Vassar graduate as its new president, but also for the way in which you have celebrated that choice through the past 2 days of panels, performances, and hospitality. An inauguration is an opportunity to showcase, even to boast, and Lawrence has a lot to boast about. I suspect that Lawrence is as guilty as Vassar when it comes to taking credit for the successes of its students. Our institutions, like parents, bask in the accomplishments of our offspring, even though we know in our more reflective moments the limits of our parental-like powers of educating, advising, providing, and promoting. We are the creators of opportunity, not the manufacturers of fully assembled, flawlessly functioning graduates. But it's hard for me standing here today not to claim for Vassar at least a little bit of credit for Mark Burstein. Vassar has, of course, more than just claimed credit for Mark. We've actually claimed a considerable amount of his attention and expertise, particularly through his service as a member of our Board of Trustees. Those involved in having selected Mark to lead Lawrence will have no trouble understanding why Vassar would have sought his services. He has brought to Vassar's board, as he has brought to this moment, an astounding breadth of knowledge and experience. Having been drawn to higher education as the beneficiary of his impressive skills and intelligence, he's put himself in the position not just to lead Lawrence, but with Lawrence to contribute to the national educational conversation. Higher education is facing many challenges, challenges that require new approaches and new kinds of leaders. Access, affordability, sustainability, both financial and environmental, assessment, quality, accountability, all never losing sight of the goal of providing the best possible liberal education led by engaged and inspiring faculty. So I could go on and on and on about Mark and why I'm just so pleased and proud to be here to congratulate him, but let me give you just one specific example. 5 years ago, Vassar was charged by our accrediting agency to create a clearer, simple, and more effective governing process. They had reason to do so, in fact. Years of piecemeal revisions and additions had left us with documents that undermined their own authority. So we did what most institutions of higher education would do. We formed a committee of trustees, faculty, students, and administrators to revise what a former dean liked to refer to as the books of our people. A year or so into the project, we had little to show and limited sense of progress. Mark, who was a member of the committee, offered to chair a much leaner subcommittee with just the right mix of expertise and influence. The issues were no less complicated, and even the subcommittee meetings included some ideas that led to dead ends, as well as others that seemed more promising, even if unformed. At the end of such meetings, Mark would typically say, let me see if I can summarize where we are. And he would proceed to itemize the matters resolved, the matters unresolvable, and the matters, the resolution of which he proposed and assigned to individuals, complete with due dates. Somehow, he made it seem like there could have been no other imaginable analysis of the meeting and made everyone feel good about having been a contributor to such a productive exercise. This fall, we completed the full revision of our primary governance document, which we hope will get us through our next reaccreditation, an accomplishment which I can assure you would not have happened as soon or as successfully or perhaps ever without Mark's leadership. Such powers of organization, of having a goal, of taking the time to understand a problem and entertain different points of view are rare enough. But Mark's powers of being a careful listener and transforming what he hears into a plan of action are even rarer. I've learned over the years to value and nourish relationships with other college presidents to the benefit of both institutions. With Mark here at Lawrence, as well as on the Vassar board, I know that he and I will stay in close contact and continue to build a relationship between Vassar and Lawrence, and I very much look forward to it. Mark, thank you for your leadership and for your friendship and for the opportunity to be here today to add my and your alma mater's congratulations. I wish you and Lawrence University every continued success. Thank you.
Representatives of distinguished academic institutions, of the state of Wisconsin, of the Fox Valley communities, members of the Lawrence University Board of Trustees, administration, faculty, staff, students, and friends, I have the honor to present Mark Burstein to assume the office of President of Lawrence University. Mr. Chairman, on the unanimous recommendation of the Board of Trustees of Lawrence University, I ask you, by virtue of your office, to install him as Lawrence University's 16th president.
Professor Rosa Tapia, it is my privilege to acknowledge your presentation of Mark Burstein. Mark Burstein, you've been chosen as the 16th president of Lawrence University, in the belief that you will maintain the vibrant connection between our many graduates and their alma mater, that you will enhance the experience of our current students, and that you attract future Laurentians to our unique vision of a liberal education, a diverse and lively community of students, scholars, and artists who lead lives committed to the development of the intellect and talent and the acquisition of knowledge and understanding and the cultivation of judgment and values. By the authority invested in me as Chairman of the Board of Trustees, I do hereby declare you President of Lawrence University. You've been entrusted with the charter of the college, with its official insignia, the chain of office, and Amos Lawrence's chair, the founder's chair, long a symbol of presidential office. I commend to you the labors and spirit of all who have preceded you and pledge to you the full and unwavering support of trustees, alumni, students, staff, faculty, and friends of Lawrence University. Ladies and gentlemen, I present Mark Burstein, our 16th president.
Thank you. Thank you. All right, Loretta, thank you. Thank you so much for that warm Lawrence welcome. I also want to thank you, colleagues, for your very, very kind words. Your inspiration, humor, and example have lifted me to this position. Thank you so much. I also want to thank David's family and mine, colleagues, and friends for joining us to celebrate this moment in Lawrence's history. Great institutions are not built by one leader or even one leadership group, but by generations of excellent stewardship. I want to take a moment to acknowledge Jill and Rob Beck and Margot Warsh, who are here with us today. Would the three of you please stand? The past 34 years, Lawrence has grown and prospered. Thank you for investing in this university. I start today humbled and energized by the trust you, the Lawrence community, have placed in me. I will do all that is within my ability to fulfill that trust. After 4 months together, I also know I can count on you, students, faculty, staff, and alumni of Lawrence, to do everything in your power to move this wonderful institution forward. Let me begin at our inception. With a $10,000 commitment and a direction to look south of Green Bay before the football team was established, a little bit before, three Methodist clergymen, Smith, Sampson, and Coleman, set out on a journey to found a college. Declared a territory in 1836, when its total population reached the 10,000 person threshold, Wisconsin was in the midst of a land rush. The area these three men explored was populated by Native Americans and anchored by European settlements in Fond du Lac and Green Bay. The Fox River itself provided the major transportation artery, the key food source, wild rice, which grew at its riverbanks, and a boundary between the settlement to the southeast and the untamed lands to the northwest. Steamer service on Lake Winnebago would not be introduced for another 10 years, and the upper reaches of the river would continue to be navigated primarily by Native American dugouts into the 1850s. Although Amos Lawrence's correspondence focused frequently on land transactions and the possibility the new institution would, in quotes, improve the neighborhood of my own land, these three clergymen, especially our first president, William Sampson, believed that Providence had brought them to this task and provided a unique opportunity to have a lasting impact on their community and the world. Describing this extraordinary opportunity, Sampson wrote, "The importance of this work in a republic like ours, where sovereignty is vested in the people and the perpetuity of our civil and religious institutions depends on virtue and intelligence." Of course, our founders did not agree about everything. Lawrence tried on numerous occasions to dissuade the clergymen from their attempt to establish a coeducational college, with both men and women sharing the classroom. But lucky to us, letter after letter on this topic were ignored by Sampson and his colleagues. Once the college was founded, conditions were primitive. After arriving, Sampson spent his first day clearing brush to create a field for construction. Only Henry Coleman moved with his wife and daughter, while Sampson waited for a year to bring his family
allowing time to build the first house in the area. Soon after the founding of the college, Reader Smith, the third of our trio, and the trustees parted ways. To honor his wife, Lawrence decided to give the town that began to form around the college his wife's name, his wife's maiden name, Appleton. They later decided to change the story, suggesting it was named for her uncle, right before they asked him to endow the new library. Peter Gilbert, of course, is clapping for the library. Thank you, Peter. In short, the dynamics of our founding, including resource constraint, human ingenuity, and the importance of excellent leadership, continue to be themes that shape the university today. Despite these challenges, in 1857, 10 years after our founding, Amos Lawrence wrote to his wife during his only trip to Wisconsin that this college will stand in future generations and be a blessing to the country and the world when we shall have crumbled away. It is a great and good work, and I am glad to have had a hand in it. This story of our founding brings to mind Perry Miller, whose work, Errand into the Wilderness, I encountered my freshman year of college. Reading this book confirmed my decision to major in history, and it posits a theory that has two central tenets. The Puritans of the 1600s immigrated to New England to create a city upon a hill, a phrase coined by John Winthrop, the colony's first governor. The colonists on this errand encountered an environment unknown in Europe, a vast wilderness. This combination of religious calling and pioneering in a vast unknown natural world gave rise to such central values of American culture as democracy, religious tolerance, and the centrality of education. Frederick Jackson Turner offered a similar interpretation of American history in a paper he presented in 1893, entitled "The Significance of the Frontier in American History." Turner had a personal connection to the frontier and to Wisconsin. He was born in 1861 in Portage, Wisconsin, the piece of land used to haul boats from the Wisconsin River, gateway to the Mississippi, to the Fox River, the primary connection to the Great Lakes. He writes in this paper, "American social development has been continually beginning over again on the frontier. This perennial rebirth, this fluidity of American life, this expansion westward with its new opportunities, furnish the forces dominating the American character." This same combination of religious errand and rough, natural frontier environment described by Miller confronted our own clergymen founders at the liminal moment in our history, and it propelled them forward. In their correspondence and writings, one sees that their experience in a territory that was trying to become a full-fledged state reinforced their conviction that increasing higher education opportunities in Wisconsin would strengthen democracy. Frontier life, which meant that all hands were necessary for survival, no matter what your gender, could also have reinforced their belief that the university must be coeducational, even though only one example of a college for both sexes existed in the 1840s, and their benefactor did not support this, at the time, radical concept. Now, how do we, at a time when the Fox Cities has a larger population than all of the state had at our founding, sustain this creative sense of an institution on the frontier of knowledge, social acceptance, and learning? Like our founders, we also live in an uncertain world, on the boundary between what is known and what is new, where different ideas and concepts intersect and new possibilities exist. For us, as it was for them, such a situation is critical for individual growth and for a thriving learning environment. How can we use our founding narrative to sustain this state of mind? Can we find a way as a community to rejoin Samson and his band, struggling to lift up an institution in an environment full of the unknown? As Laurentians, I believe this is our birthright and our distinguishing characteristic. We know how to fully embrace the frontier, the unknown, the radical, the unexpected, because we have done it before. For some, a frontier implies both a clear sense of what is core or central and an understanding of what is on the boundary of your physical land, your intellectual concept, or your experience. Of the many questions I have received since my appointment last December, the one most frequently asked is, why have I chosen to leave the East Coast and my home, the Princeton community, to join you here? Since the moment David and I visited Appleton over a year ago, I have grown to love three central aspects of Lawrence. We are a community that offers a rigorous academic experience filled with personal attention from a dedicated faculty. We do not tailor this experience to only the academically gifted. We open our community to the intellectually engaged. Thus, for most Laurentians, time at Lawrence is truly life-changing. And we sustain an environment focused on learning and community. This focus permeates everything we do and are. I believe that if we can sustain these three distinctive core strengths, and if we can take our inspiration from our founding on the frontier, this state of mind of human discovery, learning, and community values, our university, a great and good work, will continue to make important contributions to this world and the nation, and will thrive for the next century and beyond. Thank you all for joining us to celebrate Lawrence, our past, present, and future.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Now let me fly, yes, Lord, to let your light. Now let me fly, now let me fly, 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 fly. Thank you.